keep it a secret? To protect your pet dragon? Are you serious?
Yes.
Okay. Then what do we do?
Boom.
You are the bravest, most stubborn knucklehead I know.
Say the things that you think, but you keep inside because you're afraid that they'll be cheesy.
I am the person I am today because of you.
There is strength in her that gives him strength.
So, what are you gonna do about it?
What a great score. What a great couple. It's all great. Be like Hiccup and Astrid. Support each other and be there for each other. Hello and welcome to Cinema Therapy. I'm Jonathan Decker, licensed therapist who loves movies. This is
Alan Seawright, a professional filmmaker who needs so much therapy.
And today we are going to do a couple's goals for Hiccup and Astrid from How to Train Your Dragon.
Movie couples therapy.
No, it's not.
It's not?
It started as movie couples therapy, and then I watched the trilogy and I'm like, there's no therapy
there's
to
no
get.
Therapy to get. Okay, well, there you go. This is,
and people in our comments are very often asking for examples of healthy relationships. They're saying, I don't even know what this looks like. So we're going to discuss why these two are couples goals and why we should model our relationships after them.
Okay, then.
So number one, they are mutually open-minded.
Now get me down.
Toothless. Down. Gently. See? Nothing to be afraid of.
Toothless! What is wrong with you? Mad Dragon! He said he's not usually like this.
Oh no.
Toothless, what are you doing? We need her to like us! And now the spinning. Thank you for nothing, you useless reptile.
Okay, I'm sorry. Just get me off of this thing.
And now it's... I love the music, how the music shifts.
Yeah. The score in this movie is so good.
Okay, so first thing that comes to mind is... the trope of impressing the girl with your sweet ride.
Uh-huh.
Like Aladdin with his carpet, Superman with his Superman, but taking Lois flying, taking him for a drive. I think this movie probably does it the best.
It's hard to top My Ride's a Dragon.
Yeah. So, but what's important here is they've both been raised to fear and hate dragons and to kill dragons. And of course, he has his whole... he's got several interactions with Toothless to come around and change his mind.
Yeah.
She does it pretty quickly when she sees what he sees, right? And that's something that I always appreciate about Astrid is she's tough and she's gritty, but she's also fair and open-minded.
Hang on, we gotta listen to this score for a second. Okay, continue.
And so, I mean, he's able to have his mind change with new evidence. He doesn't have to cling to things out of pride, and she's the same way, which is a reason why they're such a good fit for each other.
Yeah.
Talk to me about how, look at this. This, none of this is real. This is all created. I mean, that's real, I guess.
The feelings are real. Yeah, look, it's beautiful. There's great... animation, there's great effects work, obviously the modeling and the layout, you know,
and again,
all the artists at DreamWorks did an amazing job on this. But I mean, the hero here is John Powell.
Yeah.
This...
amazing. He's amazing. So what now?
So what now? The How to Train Your Dragon score is sort of famously every... film composer's favorite score.
Yeah.
And I asked a buddy of mine, who's a film composer, I asked him, why is that? Why do so many film composers love this score so much? And his response was fantastic. He said that it is melodically simple. You can watch the movie once and be humming three different themes from it for days.
Yeah.
So it's melodically simple, but it is orchestrationally super complex.
Yeah.
Like there's a whole lot going on. And he says that composers love it so much because they listen to it and they're just in awe of all these things that are happening. And there are a lot of composers that could sort of imitate it or kind of like, you know, reverse engineer it.
Yeah.
And do a similar thing. There are not a lot of composers who could come up with something and just do it from whole cloth that well.
I can't tell you how many times we've been filming this show and Alan's like, why am I feeling things? What is happening?
John Powell, stop it.
This episode is sponsored by Surfshark.
Surfshark is a VPN, otherwise known as a virtual private network.
With Surfshark, you can change your virtual location when you're traveling so you can connect back to your country so you can still access all your favorite sites.
Oh, like if you're out searching for other dragons across the Northern Sea?
Sure. I don't think they had the internet in Burke.
But they did have fishing nets.
Yes, they did. Surfshark's clean web automatically blocks more than 1 million known malicious websites and phishing methods.
Why would you want to block phishing? How would you feed your dragons?
Not that kind of phishing.
Oh, right! The kind that tries to steal your online info. I know about things.
Surfshark Alert is part of an add-on security combo that monitors your personal data, checks for potential breaches, and gives you real-time breach alerts.
Like when the Burkians lit the signal beacons when the dragons were trying to steal their sheep before they learned that they could just be friends?
And it has GPS spoofing on Android.
So if you're trying to find the hidden world and hide your location from Grimmel and his band of dragon hunters?
It can fool apps that track your geographical location.
Get Surfshark VPN at surfshark.deals. /cinematherapy and enter promo code
cinematherapy
for a holiday special offer and 5 extra months for how much?
Frio.
No dollars. 2 sheep. It doesn't cost any sheep, I was kidding.
So they're mutually open-minded. Second, they are communicative. Did I say that word correctly?
There were a lot of consonants in it, so probably.
They were communicative and supportive.
Okay. Dolly zoom there to show how spooky it is.
All right, bud, we gotta get out of here. Now!
I love that you can feel the weight of this thing.
Yeah.
And how it moves.
The animation is so good.
It makes sense. It's like a giant beehive. They're the workers, and that's their queen. It controls them. Let's find your dad.
No, no. No. Not yet. They'll kill Toothless. No, Astrid, we have to think this through carefully.
Hiccup, we just discovered the dragon's nest. The thing we've been after since Vikings first sailed here. And you want to keep it a secret? To protect your pet dragon? Are you serious?
Yes.
Okay. Then what do we do?
Just
boom.
Until tomorrow. I'll figure something out.
Okay. That's for kidnapping me. That's for everything else.
This is the beauty of Astrid. She's strong and she's stubborn, but she also cares deeply.
Mm-hmm.
And she listens. And a lot of strong and stubborn people don't listen.
Don't listen, yeah, exactly.
But the moment he says yes, you know, that's exactly what I'm going to do, you could see her just like let it set in, and then she goes, okay, so what do we do?
Mm-hmm.
You know? And they're not a couple yet, but they're well on their way.
Yes. We know where this is going.
We know where this is going. And she's modeling that when you're in a relationship with somebody, what matters to them matters to you. And it doesn't have to be a romantic relationship. You've heard me talk about my mom taking an interest in Jackie Chan movies,
mm-hmm.
which was not her natural setting.
No.
But she saw, okay, this matters to my son, so it matters to me, right?
Mm-hmm.
And that's a healthy relationship. That's communicative and supportive.
Yeah.
Number 3, they understand the difference between playful teasing and hurtful sarcasm.
Afternoon, m'lady.
Where have you been?
Well, winning races, what else? The real question is, where have you been?
Avoiding my dad.
Oh no, what happened now?
Oh, you're gonna love this. I wake up, the sun shining, terrible terrors are singing on the rooftop. I saunter down to breakfast, thinking all is right with the world, and I get...
Son, we need to talk.
Not now, Dad. I got a whole day of goofing off to get started.
First of all, I don't sound like that. What is this character? And second, what is that thing you're doing with my shoulders? Yeah, okay, that's a really flattering impersonation. Anyway, he goes,
"You're the pride of Berk, son, and I couldn't be prouder."
Aw, thanks, Dad. I'm pretty impressed with myself, too.
When have I ever done that with my hands?
You just did.
Okay, just hold still. Very serious.
You're all grown up, and since no chief could ask for a better successor, I've decided—
To make you chief! Oh my gods! Hiccup, that's amazing!
Oh. You're gonna wear out the spring coil. The calibration is very sensitive. Yeah.
Okay, so she is really taking the piss out of him.
Yeah.
And he's not mad, and he's not hurt. And you could say, well, that's because of his maturity. But here's the thing. A lot of people attempt playful teasing, and it lands as hurtful sarcasm.
They miss.
Ooh. Yeah, big miss. And the biggest difference, like, what determines that? It's a couple of factors. One is intent. But not just intent. What is the overall level of respect and affection in the relationship?
Yeah.
The fact is, you and I can tease each other about stuff that's real. It's not even silly. It's like actual me teasing you about your crap or weaknesses and vice versa. And generally speaking, not always, generally speaking, no one gets hurt or offended. And we have the ability to say, hey, that one is offsides. That was...
That was a little too close to yellow card.
And the reason for that is because we build up respect and affection in our relationship.
Well, we've been at it for 20 years and we put work in.
Yeah.
Yeah.
If you feel like this person respects you and loves you, then when they're teasing you, it registers as affection, especially if it's not a joke that's meant to, like, cover a critique or a jab. You know, I'm not criticizing you, but making it a joke. She thinks the way he talks with his hands is adorable.
Yeah.
It's not something that annoys her. If it were playful sarcasm, then she'd be doing the exact same thing, but the tone would be, I'm annoyed at this and you're an idiot, yes. Right? And he would get defensive. Mastering this in, this is one of the greatest flirtatious love languages in movies and in real life, right? You have this with Megan really well.
This is the reason I am married to Megan, is because within minutes of meeting her, she was doing that to me. And I could tell it was not out of, you know, malice or anything. It was just like, she's a very relatively quiet, very introverted person, and I am not. And she immediately clocked that and was just like, this guy can handle it.
Yeah, exactly. So some people have a lot of pain from judgment and from rejection. And yeah, they're going to be very sensitive to your attempts at playful teasing and it's not going to land. Build up respect and affection in your relationship through what John Gottman calls 5-to-1. For every one negative or potentially negative interaction, there needs to be at least 5 where you're building them up, where you're expressing gratitude, where you're being affectionate, where you're enjoying each other. It's not an exact science. Some people say 10-to-1, 20-to-1. The principle matters more than the number.
Yeah.
When you build up that store of, I really feel safe with this person, then the teasing becomes about affection and not about annoyance or frustration, and you get beautiful moments like this in real life.
What's really impressive to me is the animators, because it takes a lot of work. Astrid is imitating Hiccup, but animators are animating Astrid to move like she's imitating Hiccup. So it doesn't look like Hiccup, because they could just animate Hiccup onto her body.
Yeah.
But they're not doing that, they're doing an imitation. That is mastery of the craft of animation.
Like, yeah.
It is incredible what this team did.
Number 4, they unite their strengths. In any relationship, there's going to be differences, no matter how alike you are.
Oh,
like,
sure.
You and Megan are very much alike, but you also have different strengths. And something that I've noticed you two do is you unite those to be a team.
I try to avoid looking at her. It gives me acid reflux.
Okay, guys, just keep your helmets on. Toothless and I will
fight. Toothless has the light fury now. He's probably not even coming back.
What?
You gave him his freedom, Hiccup. What were you expecting?
I never thought he'd stay away for good. I look, I'll figure it out. I just need more time.
He thinks he has to lead alone. Well, because his father had to. He doesn't realize the strength you have together. Do you still believe in him?
Of course. I wish he did. But he thinks he's nothing without Toothless.
Then help him realize the truth.
Get on! on.
What?
We're going to find him.
Really? Everybody stay put. We will get Roughnut back. Don't worry.
So Astrid says to Hiccup's mother he feels like he has to do it alone. He also feels like he's nothing without Toothless. And Mom says help him to realize. And I love that the way she helps him to realize it. I'm expecting, if I'm watching this for a first time, Astrid to walk over and for there to be some sort of heart-to-heart. Instead, she just goes thump right in front of him with the dragon. And she's like, get in, loser.
Get in, loser. We're going shopping.
He immediately, he's grateful for her allyship. And there is strength in her that gives him strength. One of you has to anchor while the other is struggling, and then you kind of do a dance with that. But that's one of the reasons why you have each other. And they do that beautifully. They unite their strengths, and they solve problems together.
I think Astrid realizes here that Hiccup's strength is solving problems, right? He can engineer solutions to things. This is what he always does. And so instead of letting him sort of wallow, she puts him in a situation where it's like, you're going to need to solve a problem. I'm going to give you a problem that you can like engineer a way out of.
Yeah. She knows him so well.
She knows him. Yep.
Today I am munching on our cookies and cream flavor popcorn. What do you got?
Jalapeno cheddar, because it's hot like dragon fire.
It's fiery. We love it. Go to ctpopcorn.com and get your very own Movie Dad's popcorn. It's delicious and delightful.
It has our faces on it.
Number 5, be encouraging and supportive.
He listened to you.
Don't say it.
I wasn't going to.
I shouldn't have dragged you out there. He wouldn't have flown me back. She wouldn't have followed.
Yep.
Ah, I feel like the same screw-up I was before I met Toothless.
I can see that.
Are you just gonna stand there and agree with everything?
Well, you're right. You're back to where you started. But I was the first to believe in you. And I have watched you doubt whether you're worthy ever since. But you know what? I am the person I am today because of you. I never told you that, but it's true. You are the bravest, most stubborn, most determined knucklehead I know. Toothless didn't give you that, Hiccup. He just made it
easier.
And now it's gonna be a lot harder. So, what are you gonna do about it?
Probably something stupid.
That's the Hiccup I know.
Shoot up, gang. We're going to get them back.
I actually don't even have really any notes on that scene. Be encouraging and supportive. Well, I guess what I will say is say the things that you think, but you keep inside because you're afraid that they'll be cheesy, right?
Yeah.
Actually say those vulnerable, beautiful things. We don't want to have the full house moments. We go, we roll our eyes. But then when you actually have them, it's like, oh, that was actually kind of nice.
They're pretty good.
And what I needed, right? And that's how we're there for each other. And she's validating his negative emotions, but then helping him work through them, right? When he says,
yeah, for sure.
All the things, I feel like the same loser that I felt like before. But here's what, she doesn't say, I agree. She says, I can see that.
Yeah.
And he originally thinks she's agreeing with him, but she's not. She's saying, I can see that
you can see that you think that.
Yeah.
That's dumb.
And I love the ability to say to somebody, that's dumb. And instead of them taking it as an insult, they take it as this thinking right now, you're not dumb, but this is dumb. And here's why you should believe in yourself. And here's why you're great. Right. And we all need that from our friends and our loved ones. But here's the big secret. We can do it for ourselves.
You can sass yourself in the privacy of your own home.
And then number 6, what does that even mean?
No one knows. Least of all me.
Number 6, work as a team. I want a
you
Viking
bow to
wedding.
No one. Yeah,
yeah,
I do
seriously.
Too.
Just look at those clothes. That's legit.
Straight up.
You could pull that look off.
I got married in Utah too. We have mountains, not like that at all, but kind of. We don't have an ocean though.
So now, of course, they're missing their dragons.
There were dragons when I was a boy.
Like that his son has
there were great
his eyes,
yeah.
But Astrid's hair.
Like gigantic scary birds. Little brown scuttly dragons.
So I like this scene because, I mean, I know it's on the nose, but look at them. They've both got different roles. They're both handling different things. And the roles aren't determined by gender. They're determined by what they agree on, like who's going to do what, right?
Some say they crawled back into the sea, leaving not a bone nor a fang for men to remember them by. Others say they were nothing but folktales to begin with.
He's rocking that beard.
Oh,
You ever see the meme that says John Krasinski is Hiccup? You look at him in The Office, and you look at Hiccup in the first movie.
What?
And you look at Krasinski now with his beard, and...
Holy crap.
Yeah.
Honestly, Astrid and Emily Blunt aren't that far off either.
Yeah.
Wild.
Hey. Hey there, bud.
Should have shaved before. He's gonna eat you now.
Remember me?
It's okay.
I like that you see it in the eyes first. Yep.
Pupils dilate.
Glad to see you too, bud.
He's not gonna eat your father.
How's the tail holding up? Probably could use some oil and a little fine tuning.
Look, it's okay.
So they run the ship together, they raise the kids together. Here. She's protecting and reassuring.
It's all right.
Come.
While he's securing the dragon situation. And then they're both together.
Like this.
Making this moment happen. I look at the daughter looking.
Let him come to you.
I love the sun's covering his eyes. And this is ultimately the culmination of what makes them such a great couple.
Yeah.
Shared interests. A lot of similarities to bond them. Building on the strengths that their differences bring. Encouraging and supporting and uplifting each other. And working as a team, working as a unit. Plus, their life has a pretty badass musical score.
Pretty freaking good.
What's got you tearing up now? I'm not judging.
It's the musical score.
Is it the musical score?
Yeah. And the thought of, like, taking my son to fly on a dragon would be pretty cool.
Legend says that when the ground quakes...
Do the Avatar ride at Disney World, I promise.
Yeah, I know. I gotta go.
No, they're still here. Waiting for us to figure out how to get along.
I love that she's got her dragon, but the Light Fury is never domesticated.
Yeah, nobody ever flies on it.
The dragons are gone, if they ever existed at all. But we Burkians, we know otherwise. And we'll guard the secret until the time comes when dragons can return in peace.
Come on. What a great score. What a great couple. It's all great. Be like Hiccup and Astrid and domesticate wild animals that don't want to be domesticated.
No, don't do that.
Is that not the takeaway?
That's not. Nope. Bad idea.
Be like Hiccup and Astrid and support each other and be there for each other.
Yeah, do that. That's
okay.
Better.
Yay.
Yay. We solved it. So until next time.
What is this thing that you have me doing with my shoulders? I don't do
that. I don't know. You do it all the time.
We're taking it. We're running with it. And watch movies. You're Hiccup. You're Astrid imitating Hiccup.
What's a good
What's not your finest talent? Special shout out to our patrons over at our Patreon. You could be one of the people that we shout out. People like
Mitchell Harris,
Itzia Munoz or Munoz. I think it's Munoz.
Hey, it's Munoz. Tammy Allen.
Yes. Yes, it's me.
That's the name. Is yes, it's me.
That's the name. Yeah, that's the name.
William Story, which sounds like the villain in a Jane Austen novel.
There you go.
Get his Lord William Story. Go to Patreon and have 10,000 a year with Lord William Story.
Wow.